Thank you very much, Auntie Elby, for reading the scripture po para sa atin. Magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
And we thank the Lord for this continuation of our study of the book of Nehemiah. Tayo po'y manalangin. Ama naming Diyos, kami po ay nagpapasalamat sa iyo. We thank you and honor you, Panginoon, sa pagkakataon ito that we could come and ponder upon your words. Salamat po, Panginoon, sa pagkatigaw ang Diyos na nagbibigay sa amin ng illumination. And we know, Panginoon, that this morning that you will speak forth your word sa aming buhay. At inihiling namin, Panginoon, ang iyong banal na spirito na siyang manguna sa amin, Panginoon. Bigyan mo po kami ng isang tender heart, Panginoon, na maging receptive ang aming mga puso sa pakikinig ng iyong salita. That through the preaching of your word, Lord, ay makikita namin ang aming mga sarili sa mga bagay na nais mo, Panginoon, sa aming buhay. Tulungan mo kami, Panginoon, that we will not just simply listen to your words, but we pray, Lord, that we will be doers of your word as well. Salamat po sa pangalan po ng aming Panginoong Jesus.
Amen.
We are now in chapter 3 of our study of the book of Nehemiah. And we know na ito po ay tinatawag natin that the book of Nehemiah was taken from the memory of this minor prophet by the name of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. And from this recollection of the story of Nehemiah, we can see that we are now in chapter 3 at ito po ay isang panahon that everything will be put into work and into action, that after a prayer period of 4 to 5 months, that after Nehemiah prayed and fasted, after Nehemiah sat down and mourned for the nation of Israel was in great distress and in great reproach, we can see that now is the time for them to move and to work. We know that when we, just like the things that we have studied last time, we know that the prayer period of 4 to 5 months would be nothing without the accompaniment of work. And we believe that this is something that is very important sa ating buhay. It is not enough for us to learn, and it is not enough for us to, you know, to have our fattened heart and mind sa pamamagitan po ng good exposition of the Word of God without the accompaniment of the application. This is the beauty of understanding the Bible. We can see that understanding a lot of wonderful things about the Word of God and probably memorizing a lot of key doctrines in the Bible without the accompaniment of application, then everything would be futile. Kaya napakahalaga sa buhay po natin na maintindihan natin that we have to work together in order for us to achieve a common goal. That's why the title of our message this morning is The Beauty of Synergy. The beauty of synergy. We all know that the word synergy simply means strength and number. And it became the mantra of a lot of people, a lot of groups, a lot of organizations, even basketball teams. We don't know if, you know, the Warriors use this mantra, this guiding principle, to connote the idea of what we call strength in numbers, whether if that is the number of shots delivered or the number of baskets contributed. Or probably that could be the word synergy is in the perspective of those people who are supporting their team. Because every time that they will transfer from their home court to another state, we know that a lot of people will just simply follow them, and probably that could be the idea of what we call strength in numbers. They are plenty, they are innumerable. So we know that as we go to the study of chapter 3 of Nehemiah, probably you will agree with me into telling, Lord, what would be your message to me? Auntie Elby read something about all the names and some of the projects in chapter 3 of Nehemiah. Let me give you some of the samples, and probably if you are thinking and contemplating about a potential name of your future child, probably you can get something from this. Right? Now, let me tell you, Eliashib, the high priest, and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the tower of the 100, which they dedicated as far as the tower of Hananel. The men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Imri, built next to them. Now the fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hasena. They laid its beam and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Meremoth, the son of Uriah, the son of Hakkoz, repaired the next section next to him. Meshulam, son of Bekiah, the son of Meshisabel, made repairs, and next to him, Sadok, son of Baana, also made repairs. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. Now, the Jesana, the gate was repaired by Jehoiada, son of Paseah, and Meshulam. What is the meaning of all these names? And you will see that this is something that we have to understand in chapter 3. And definitely, if you're trying to make a good sermon out of these names, definitely you have to get the context of this. Without understanding the context of this, then this chapter will just be names and places wherein all these names given made their own work and repaired the walls of Jerusalem and the gates. But notice, one of the wonderful words of Nehemiah can be described in this very simple sentence. That means, come, let us arise and build. Try to imagine that after a prayer period of 4 to 5 months, now Nehemiah is summoning all the people in the nation of Israel, and he said something like this. This is a reverberating message that Nehemiah gave to the people by simply saying, let us arise and build. So that means you have to wake up from your slumber, you have to rise up from your sitting, and you have to do something. So that means this is something that is very important in the idea of what we call synergy. Last time I told you that humongous task needs a humongous help. Hindi natin pwedeng gawin ang isang bagay na napakalaki na kung saan ilan lamang yung nagtulong-tulong. So that's why we know that Nehemiah summoned the entire nation of Israel and he said, arise, let us build. Nehemiah is not giving a suggestion to these people. Nehemiah is giving them a command. You will see that the command given by Nehemiah is in the form of imperative sentence. Let us arise, and the second part of the sentence is, let us build. So that means two commands in a row wherein Nehemiah summoned all these people, and this will be their guiding principle. Dr. Wiersbe once said in his commentary about this book of Nehemiah, he said something like this. Nehemiah faced a great challenge with a great faith in his great God, but he can never accomplish much without the help from those people in the nation of Israel. Let me repeat the wonderful commentary of Dr. Wiersbe. Sabi niya, Nehemiah faced a great challenge with a great faith in a great God. There's no doubt about that, but he can never accomplish much without the great help from those people in the nation of Israel. Such thing promotes what we call synergy. Nehemiah is telling to them, in effect, I cannot do this alone. I cannot build the walls of Jerusalem alone. I need your help. You have to arise and build. Let us go and try, you know, working together as one. When it comes to the work of the Lord, there is no place for what we call spectators. But sad to say, you know, sometimes even in churches, there are a lot of spectators. Not just spectators, there are a lot of critics. And the sad part of the story is that all those people who are very critical are those people who are not putting their hands upon the work. Yun yung napakatinding realidad ng buhay sa napakaraming mga churches. Those people who are very critical, those people who are, you know, giving nasty comments are those people who are not even doing their work. And we know that, sabi po ni Nehemiah, in effect to every one of us, when it comes to the Lord's work, especially in building the walls of Jerusalem or in fortifying our testimonies as a church, there is no place for what we call spectators. There is no place also for what we call self-appointed advisors. Nakakalungkot, no? May mga taong nag-a-advise not for the betterment of our ministry. A lot of people are just giving advice to, you know, to kill all your potential, and probably to criticize you. And that's why even critics doesn't have any place in the work of God, especially if you are not doing something for Him. But there is always room for what we call willing workers. So Nehemiah encouraged these people to participate in the building of the wall. And we know that, you know, just like when I told you last time that there are three types of people, right? Can you still recall that? The immovable, the movable, and the mover. The one that is causing people to move. But let me tell you another version of these three types of people. And probably you will evaluate yourself using this idea. Number one is those people who want things happen. There are people whose life can be characterized by this. They want things to happen. And these are basically those people who are, you know, telling you have to do something, but they themselves are not willing to work. The other type of people is those who are expecting things to happen. These are the spectators. One is what we call, they want things to happen. They demand that all these things must happen. The other one is, you know, they are just expecting things to happen. They are just seeing every members of the church if they are doing something for the Lord. Because they are just spectators. The third one is those who make things happen. Where are you in this tree? Just like the immovable, the movable, and the mover. That's why in chapter 3 of Nehemiah, you will realize that this is true. Those who want things to happen, those who are expecting things to happen, and the other one is those who make things happen. The question is, how did Nehemiah promote synergy? Paano po kaya, in his own ways, that you think that Nehemiah promoted synergy? The people coming together and in order for them to work. Let me just give you at least three things in which Nehemiah promoted synergy when it comes to what we call the work done by those people. Number one, we have to understand that in the purpose, in the idea of what we call the purpose of their work. And definitely, if you want people to work together, you have to give them the purpose why you are asking them to do things for the group. And we know that in chapter 3, verse 1 alone, you will see that then Eliashib, the high priest, rose up with his brethren. In the NIV translation, it was translated Eliashib together with some of the priests. So definitely, these are the Levites. Because we know that those priests cannot be priests if they do not belong to the tribe of Levi. And we believe that this is something that is very important. His brethren, the priests, and built up the sheep gate. They consecrated it and hung its doors. They built as far as the Tower of the 100 and consecrated it as far as the Tower of Hananil. You will realize that the introduction portion alone of Nehemiah chapter 3 mentions something about those people who led the construction. especially those people who are called the priests. Now, to understand this, you have to know that the purpose of the work must be done in what we call the right response of those people. The group of priests is the most difficult group of people to respond positively to the challenge given by Nehemiah to start building the wall. Why? You will realize that as you go back and try to understand Ezra, because Ezra went first and entered Jerusalem after the captivity, and we know that Ezra failed in rebuilding the wall. That's why Nehemiah was asked by the Lord in order for him to continue on the things that had started by Ezra. But you will realize that Nehemiah attacked first the group of priests. If there are very critical people, especially during the time of Jesus, that must be the priest, the group of priests. They are not gullible people. Definitely, before they will do something, they would ask something. And probably one of the questions that this priest asked to Nehemiah was that, you know, our leader Ezra already constructed this and he failed. What makes you think that you can succeed in rebuilding the wall of Jerusalem? He tried it before, repairing to Ezra, and we tried it with Ezra, and yet we failed. What makes you think that the construction of the wall will just be finished in no time? But even then, we can see that Nehemiah encouraged this group of people. Probably one of the many questions that they had asked was something like this: what made you think that we can succeed this time? Give us a proof. You know, critical people are always like that. What made you think that you will become successful in this endeavor? Going back to chapter 2, verse 17, Nehemiah said, "Then I said to them, you see the distress that we are in. How Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates are burned with fire." Now look at the admonition of Nehemiah. "Come, let us build the walls of Jerusalem so that we may no longer be a reproach." What an encouragement indeed. You can never solicit any help from anyone once you fail to encourage them. Look at the bold part of my slide. Nehemiah said, "Come, let us build the walls of Jerusalem so that we," the pronoun "we" is very important. Nehemiah said, "we," that includes a group of priests, especially they are the leaders of the nation of Israel. He said, "so we may no longer be a reproach." You see, the nation of Israel was called by God, and they are called God's chosen people. Definitely, God blessed them with so much blessing, and now they are in what we call the period of reproach.